In today's video, I'm gonna go over the settings for my new Canon EOS R5, so let's get started. For the last 2.5 or so years, I've been using the Canon EOS 5D Mark IV. And so coming to the R5 is a little bit of a change because I haven't used a mirrorless camera before. So in today's video, I'm gonna go over step by step how I set up the camera in the menu so that when you get your camera, you'll sort of have an idea of what I did, and maybe that will help you do what you're gonna do. So let's go over things one item at a time. We'll start off in the red menu, and the very first thing that I would do is set the cropping aspect ratio to 4:3. And the reason for that is because when I'm shooting in my studio, what I'm always looking for is an 8:10 composition. And looking through a 2:3 viewfinder is a little bit of a problem for me because I'm always going to fill up whatever box you give me. So 4:3 is fairly close to 8:10. It's not perfect, but it's a lot closer than a 2:3. And the other thing is, as long as you're shooting RAW plus JPEG, it will give you a cropped JPEG and the RAW file with a crop attached to it, which you can then move around in post. This is gonna speed up my workflow a lot and make things a lot easier for me, because when I do a client shoot, I'm not gonna have to go through and look at every frame and make sure that I have an 8:10 crop on there applied correctly, or just also to make sure that I'm not giving my clients a JPEG with extra floor in the bottom, or you know, a softbox, you know, right here above the person's head. The next thing I would go to is I'm just gonna go through the menus here. Now, anti-flicker, I do enable when I'm shooting video, but for this video right now, I'm gonna focus just on the still setting, and then I'll switch the camera over into video mode and we'll go over everything step by step. So I always set the color space in my cameras to sRGB. And the reason is that Adobe RGB is a color space that's great for printing, but it looks pretty bad on the web. And so I just like to have things ready to go for the internet, because almost all of our clients are gonna use our pictures online. And then if a client, like a graphic designer or an ad agency, requests from me a TIFF file in Adobe RGB, I will convert and give them that. Okay, so the next big thing for me in menu 6 is the shutter. Now, I did a test before shooting sports and I used an electronic shutter and I didn't like the results. A lot of people disagreed with me, but I thought that there was going to be too much movement that would cause there to be a problem with the photos. So for right now, I'm setting the shutter to mechanical. Also, in the manual, it says that if you use the first curtain electronic shutter, you shouldn't do so with a fast lens wide open. Now, a big question for me is a 400mm 2.8 a fast lens? Or are they just talking about an 85 1.2? So for me right now, I don't think I'm gonna use the first curtain electronic, because a lot of the times I shoot wide open and I wouldn't want that to cause me a problem. So I'm just gonna stick to the mechanical shutter. However, the manual does say that if you use a first curtain electronic shutter, that you can shoot at a sync speed of a 250th of a second. This may be an advantage for you, but I don't really think, for me, practically speaking, there's that big of a difference between 1/250th and 1/200th of a second, but you might want to consider that. Okay, and right below the shutter is the next thing we need to talk about, which is whether or not you want to let your camera fire without a card inside. I think by default, the camera ships with the ability to shoot pictures without cards inside, which I think is kind of crazy. So every time I get a new camera, I set it up so that it won't fire unless there's a disc in there. Because the last thing that I want to do is be recording pictures into thin air that just disappear. This isn't Snapchat, this is a camera. In the 7th submenu is image stabilization. And I've noticed that if I have a lens with IS built in, these settings aren't there. It seems that if I just switch the lens IS to on, then it's automatically using the lens IS and the IBIS. However, with no lens or a non-IS lens, this option comes up. So you can choose between whether or not you want the image stabilization on, and you can choose if it's going to be on all of the time or only for one shot. For my purposes, for right now, I'm going to leave it on always. Also, if you have a totally manual lens, you can tell it what millimeter that lens is, and that way it can make adjustments to the IBIS to compensate for that focal length. So just keep that in mind. So right down from IBIS is touch shutter. And I've found that a lot of the time I'm using the LCD on the back of the camera to move around my focus points. So I don't think having the touch shutter, which means that when you tap the screen, it takes a picture, is a great feature. So I'm just gonna go ahead and disable that one. Right down from touch shutter is image review. One of the things that I really like about this camera is that when I shoot a portrait in studio, it plays it for me right in the viewfinder. And it does so as long as I don't have my finger halfway pressed down on the shutter. I just set it up to come on and go off after 2 seconds. And I think this feature is fantastic because it allows you to see what you just did and make decisions about your framing or your lighting without putting the camera down. Exposure simulation is a great feature if you are a photographer who works with available light. But as a studio photographer, it doesn't really help us that much. So I just have it set up so that it only comes on when I press the depth of field preview button. So now we're going to switch over to the autofocus menus. And I think one of the greatest things about this camera is face tracking and eye detection. I used this camera on my very first shoot and I did 4 different looks at various f-stops and I got 650 out of 655 shots in focus using face and eye tracking. And it was absolutely fantastic. And I think that's going to be a true game changer about this camera coming from the 5D Mark IV. So with the 5D Mark IV photos, I would have to go over picture by picture and reject each out of focus frame manually. And this takes up a lot of time. But with the R5 and face and eye detection, I know that this camera is going to work to get almost every picture in focus. So in the autofocus menu, right there on the second setting, you just change the AF method to be face detection or face tracking. The next thing down would be to detect people. And as a studio photographer, you might be shooting pets and you might be shooting humans. So just pick the one that's appropriate for you. So for me, I like to shoot people, but not with a gun, just with this camera. Even though if you put it on at 12 frames a second, it's gonna kind of sound like that. Okay, that was all very off color, so I'm just gonna delete that out and then hopefully no one will see it and no one will leave me bad comments. But let's go on to the next thing, and that would be eye detection. I think the eye detection with this camera is fantastic. I've shot driver's license style photos with an 85, 1.4, at 1.4, and every picture is sharp. You can look in there and the pupil is what is maintained in focus, not the person's eyelashes. You don't have to worry about getting the tip of their nose in focus or maybe their eyebrow. It really does work and it's really great. So I'm going to go ahead and click on eye detection and make it say enabled. Now the next thing down is continuous autofocus. Now for the longest time, and I have used Canon cameras for like 20 years, give or take, I would set up custom function 4, not in this camera, in the other cameras. It was always custom function 4, which would make this button right here initiate focus. And that was because I would compose my photo, focus it. I'm sorry, let me reverse that. I would have maybe 1 to 5 focus points, or maybe the center focus point, or maybe a plus somewhere in the autofocus point selected. And I would put that over my subject and I would press this button to initiate focus. And when I achieve focus, I would take my thumb off of it and recompose the photo. But with this camera that's tracking faces and eyes, you don't have to worry about that anymore. So this is gonna be something that I'm gonna have to get used to because it is change, but I just have the autofocus set up to be continuous. And now I don't press a button to start focus. It just happens and it just goes and it just works. So let's go on to our next thing. And the next one down is touch and drag autofocus settings. and I have this set up to enabled. And the reason why you would use this is that you can reselect where the focus point is on the camera by touching the screen back here with your thumb, and you don't even have to take your eye off of the camera or press any other buttons. And then I think this works out great because if I'm not using face and eye detection or I need to get it set up on a different face or something like that, I just have to use my thumb and I don't have to touch any buttons or use a joystick or anything, and it so far works out great. Now I have the active touch area set up to be the right side of the frame. Okay, the funny thing is I'm going over these menus right now in real time while recording this, and I've come across something that I didn't know was turned on, and that is the AF assist firing beam. This can be a very bad and distracting thing if you're at an event and you're taking photos and your camera starts emanating this light. So you need to change the AF assist beam firing from enabled to off. Okay, our next menu is autofocus 3, and that is the autofocus cases, which sort of sets up in general how you want your camera's autofocus system to respond and react to your subjects. Now, case one is the general all-purpose one. When I shot sports professionally about 10 years ago, I always used case 4. But so far, during most of my testing, except for when I tested the camera shooting sports, I remained in case 1. Now, the next thing is the initial point for face detection in autofocus menu 5. Now, originally, I had this set up so that I had a point set near the top center of my vertical frame to begin my face and eye detection. And I found that I didn't like this because I had to go back to focus and recomposing. I would put that point over the person's face, like let's say they were in the top right corner of my frame, and then I would slide my camera back over to the composition that I wanted and then go on shooting. And I found this to be really annoying because every time I stopped shooting to take a break, I had to go back to doing this. So I have this setting set to auto, and I think that's gonna work for me most of the time. Okay, now in the play menu, and this is gonna go by really quickly, I usually don't change anything in here other than sometimes I will turn on the highlight alert and sometimes I won't. It really just depends on whether or not I wanna know that I've blown a highlight in my shot and whether or not I'm just gonna find this to be annoying to see, you know, black flashing blobs on my screen. Now for the wireless settings menus, I don't really have any specific advice for this section other than to say that the setup is different and it's pretty straightforward and easy to understand, but it is also a lot easier to reestablish a wireless connection than you were able to do with the 5D Mark IV. So I did a shoot the other day where I was shooting RAW plus large fine JPEG. And I was tethering over my 5G network to my really fast iMac using EOS Utility, and there was a bit of a lag and a delay and a backup of getting those RAW, or I should say getting those JPEG only files. I wasn't tethering the RAW, only the JPEG files from my camera to the computer. And this actually caused there to be a backup that made it so that the camera wouldn't give me review in the viewfinder, and this was sort of a bummer. So I say all of this to say that maybe it would be better with fine, or not fine, but smaller JPEGs. Maybe that sort of workflow would work. So let's move on to our next group of settings, and that is the wrench. So under the first menu, I go down to auto rotate, and I want to make sure that it's set up so that it automatically rotates on the computer only, not the computer and the camera, this first setting, but just the computer only. Then in the second menu is the video setting, and I have that set up to NTSC and not PAL because I'm located in North America. Then under beep, I have that set up to be disabled because I do not want this camera making those little chirping, beeping noises. It drives me nuts, but you know, you might be okay with that, so use your discretion. So next up is the power savings mode. And on the still side of things, I think this is very important, I have the viewfinder set off to 1 minute. And that way I'll save a lot of power. And then I have the eco mode turned on. And the reason is I want this computer or camera to shut itself down to save as much battery as possible. So let's go on to our next settings here in menu 3, and that is the screen and viewfinder display. And I have that set up to auto 2 because I want it to automatically switch between the screen and the viewfinder based on whether or not I put my eye up to the camera. And that way you won't be staring at a screen out of the corner of your eye while you're looking through the electronic viewfinder. The next thing is the screen brightness. Now I have mine set to 3. And I've tried to sort of put a file, or I should say, I've tried to look at a file on both the back screen and in the viewfinder and on my computer and tweak these settings so that they all sort of match. Now, as you know, every screen is totally different as to its white balance and its brightness characteristics. So I would assume that every camera is going to have a little bit different color and brightness. So because of that, you should go in and fine-tune these settings. So let's go over them one by one. So the screen brightness, I have mine set up to 3. The next thing is the viewfinder brightness. Same thing here, I have it set up to 2. Although I did notice when I was outdoors and I had it set up to 1, I could almost not even look at the thing. So you might want to set this to something else. I just want to make sure though, as a studio commercial photographer, that what I'm seeing through the viewfinder or on the back screen is close to what I'm going to get on the computer. So the next thing would be the screen viewfinder color tone. I have mine set up to 4. The other versions do cause a color shift in the screen, but I'm just going to keep it on 4 because that was the most neutral version for my screen. So, moving on to the fine-tune viewfinder color. I did set up mine so that it would be slightly more red. I'm still fine-tuning it. I might want to adjust it a little bit. Okay, and right below that, under user interface magnification, I have that set to enabled. And what this means is that when you double tap on the menu screen with your finger, it will zoom in. So next up is wrench 4, and I'm sure it does have an official name other than wrench, but we're just going to go with wrench because that's what it looks like to me. So under wrench 4, if you come down to shutter at shutdown, I have it set to closed. And the reason why I do that is because I want the camera to close the shutter down so that the sensor is not exposed when I take the lens off. So every time that I have gone to change lenses on this camera, I have turned it off. Right below that is sensor cleaning, and I want the sensor cleaning to happen automatically at power off. That is the very first thing, and this is most likely the default. I don't know because I feel like I went in and changed it a little, but that's what you want your camera to do. Okay, so now we're gonna move on to our next major menu system, which are the custom settings, or orange camera. At least I think this is still called custom settings. But this is where you're gonna customize the camera. And so for the most part, I've left everything at the default, but I'm gonna go over the settings that I have changed. Under menu 3, if you scroll down, you'll find custom buttons. And this is where a lot of the customization of the camera comes in. So let me go over what I've done step by step so you can get an idea of kind of what I'm thinking and where I'm coming from. So I've left the shutter to initiate the autofocus, which is different because remember I used to use this back button for that. So that's a new change for me. But I believe that is basically in function, the default for these cameras. The movie shooting button is still the movie record button. I've left mode alone. The AF on button I have changed to be the AE lock in AF off. Now the reason is sometimes I may need to focus and recompose, and if that's the case, I want to be able to halt the autofocus, and logically speaking, the AF on button made the most sense. I'm not exactly sure about that, but it does sort of make sense that if I press it, it's AF off, and if I let go, it's AF on. Maybe that doesn't make logical sense to you, but it certainly makes more sense to me than changing one of the other buttons on the camera to lock focus. So moving on to our next one, on the button that I used to use, this asterisk on the back, the button that I used to use to initiate autofocus, and then when I let go, it would stop autofocus, I now have that set to swap between the viewfinder and the rear screen. so that if I want this camera to act more like a DSLR, I will push this button, and that way I will not see a preview on the back, I will only see it in the electronic viewfinder. And this could be a battery saving mode, and it might just make me feel better that I'm not, you know, looking at some strange visual before I look into the viewfinder. I've left the depth of field preview button to be the depth of field preview button. And because of the settings that I made under the red camera menu at the beginning, that is now going to give me exposure simulation on demand when I want it, whenever I press this button. So on the video side of things, and as you'll notice in this situation, you can set up the video camera to operate differently than the stills camera. But I'll leave this alone and come back to it at the second half of this video where we're talking about the video features. And that actually sums up the customization menus. And now we're gonna move on to our final one, which is the green setting, or where you make your own custom menus. And for my first menu, number one, I've set up all the stills functions that I might want to use. So I've made it so that the cropping aspect ratio, which again, as I said earlier in the video, I like to use 4:3, is right here at my fingertips. So I can change it from normal full frame back to 4:3 or whatever it happens to be that I want to use on any given day. The next thing I have down there is the record function capability that just says where I'm going to send my photos or my videos while I'm shooting them. And we can look into that, or you could look into that individually if that's something you're interested in. The image quality settings, I have it up to RAW and JPEG. I just wanted to have this available to me here in the menu settings. My screen brightness, again, like I said, I did have a situation where I went from inside to outside, and inside 3 was great, but outside 7 was better. Now, when I had the viewfinder settings really low inside, it worked out well, but when I was outside, I needed it to be a lot brighter. So I just want to have these settings here so that I can change them on the fly as needed. And then one of the most important things that I've ever found having in the customized menus is the battery level indicator. And that's so that you're able to tell, without going through a bunch of menus, exactly what the power level settings are for your camera. And as you can see right now, I have one dead battery and one good one at 78%, but you know what? That's gonna work out fine for the demonstration, so we'll keep going. Now my second customized menu is just for video, so again, we'll come back to that. Let's talk about the outside of the camera for just a second. There are some things that are different than the 5D Mark IV, so I just wanna go over those one at a time. So in order to bring up the electronic level, I do not believe that there is a permanent setting to turn on the electronic level, which you could do in the 5D Mark IV, and I found that really helpful. In this camera, you have to press the info button twice, and then that will come up. Now, if you press the info button 4 times, you can get to the old school cue menu that you probably know and love from the 5D Mark IV. And once you get there, if you press Q, you can start changing things and moving around the joystick and making those settings. When you press the Q button, you end up getting some of the camera settings along the sides and the bottom of the frame. And it's just going to be a little bit different process than what you're used to with the 5D Mark IV and other cameras. So just know that that is something a little bit different with this camera. Anyway, guys, I hope that all made sense and that was helpful when you go to set up your R5, because I know that there are so many changes between this camera and the 5D Mark IV. If you guys have any questions or comments, or if you think that I got something wrong, please leave those below. I'm sure that everybody is going to want to set up their camera differently, and this is just sort of the way that I have it set up for me so that it works for me. Thank you guys so much for watching. Please give me a thumbs up if you have a second. And if you're watching this video on Instagram TV, just know that I always post these videos sooner to my YouTube channel. Thank you so much for your time. Stay safe and have a great day.